এই প্রচন্ড হিউমিডিটি, কিন্তু মানে বৃষ্টি হয়েছে তাতে গরমটা একটু কমেছে, বলে মানে এক সপ্তাহ আগেও এখানে খুবই বাজে একটা মানে প্যাচ প্যাচে গরম, তার সঙ্গে নর্থ ইন্ডিয়াতে যেরকম টেম্পারেচার থাকে সেরকম টেম্পারেচার, ঠিক আছে, মানে অ্যারাউন্ড 40। হ্যাঁ, তো এটা মানে খুবই আনইউজুয়াল, কারণ এখানে সাধারণত এই ধরনের গরমটা শুকনো গরম হয়।
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ শুকনো,
হ্যাঁ, তো তার ওটা গায়ে লাগে না যদি, কিন্তু এইবারে মানে অন্যরকমের গরম ছিল পুরো এখানে, এখন তারই মধ্যে ভালো হয়ে যাবে।
আচ্ছা আচ্ছা,
হ্যাঁ,
এখানে
বর্ষাকাল চলে এসেছে
সেই, হ্যাঁ
হ্যাঁ, ওখানে তো বৃষ্টি পড়ছে আমি শুনলাম, ওখানে তো বর্ষাকাল চলেই এসেছে। এবারে কি একটু তাড়াতাড়ি বর্ষা চলে এলো ওখানে? না, এরা মানে আজকে আমি আনন্দবাজারে দেখছিলাম যে বলছে নাকি তৃতীয় ওয়েভ চলে আসবে, সেটাই একটু ঝামেলার আর কি।
বাইরে তো বাড়ছেও, মানে বিভিন্ন জায়গায় তো বাড়ছে, আবার বলছে
বিভিন্ন জায়গাতে বাড়ছে।
হ্যাঁ,
সারা জীবন এরকম চলবে না তো, সেটাই ভয় লাগছে।
না, আমার মনে হয় সারা জীবন এরকম চলবে না, হয়তো আরো বছর দুয়েক।
না, এটা মোটামুটি তো প্রত্যেক 100 বছর অন্তরই এরকম 2-3 বছর 4 বছর একটা হয়েছে আর কি।
কমিউনিকেশনটা
বেড়ে গেছে, ফলে ওরাও কমিউনিকেট করতে সুবিধা হচ্ছে ওদের।
তবে এরকম চললে মুশকিল, মানে এরকম মানে আমি আজকেই আমাদের একজন মানে সে মানে ছাত্ররা আর কি, মানে যারা কোর্সের ছাত্র, তারা একটা লম্বা ইমেল করেছে। হ্যাঁ, তাদের বক্তব্য হচ্ছে যে তাদের ফোর্থ ইয়ার হয়ে গেছে, কিন্তু তারা এখনো, তারা ম্যাথামেটিক্স এর নয় অন্যান্য ডিসিপ্লিন, কিন্তু তারা এখনো ল্যাবে জিনিসপত্র নাড়াচাড়া করেনি।
হ্যাঁ সেই তো,
হ্যাঁ, তো সেটাই বলছে যে এইরকম চলতে থাকলে তো মুশকিল না, কারণ যদি ল্যাবটাই না শেখে তাহলে ওরা করে
সেটাই, ল্যাব ফিল্ড কিছুই তো হচ্ছে না।
আবার যারা ইঞ্জিনিয়ার, হাতে কলমেই না করে তাহলে ইঞ্জিনিয়ারিং কি শিখবে? হ্যাঁ, তো এইটা একটা বড় সমস্যা আর কি। আমার মনে হয় করোনা ভাইরাসে সব থেকে বেশি এফেক্টেড হয়েছে একাডেমিক। তোমার লোকজন অর্থনীতি বলছে, তারা আমার সব থেকে ক্ষতিগ্রস্ত হয়েছে পড়াশোনা।
ওকে, এবার স্টার্ট করা যাক নাকি?
হ্যাঁ,
39 হয়েছে। গুড আফটারনুন অল অফ ইউ, টুডে উই হ্যাভ এগেন ডক্টর কৃষ্ণেন্দু গঙ্গোপাধ্যায় অফ আইজার মোহালি, অ্যান্ড হি ইজ টকিং অ্যাবাউট গ্রুপস ইন জিওমেট্রি। সো ইন দ্য ফার্স্ট ক্লাস ইউ হ্যাভ সিন ডিফারেন্ট কাইন্ডস অফ সিমেট্রিজ অ্যান্ড কনজুগেসি ক্লাসেস, নাও হি উইল কন্টিনিউ। So, Krishnendu, please continue.
Oh, thank you very much, Arindamda. So, I hope my first lecture made sense to some of you. Essentially, we talked about how algebraic properties like conjugacy or the centralizers in a group can play a role in understanding the movement of transformation. All right. And then we asked the following question, and I think I stopped here. So we asked how to classify the so-called real or strongly real elements in your favorite group G, and then two related questions. But let me not emphasize the other two questions. Let me just focus on the first question for the moment. So recall that an element was called real or reversible if it was conjugate to its inverse, and an element was called strongly reversible or strongly real if it was product of two involutions in a group G. Now this is a problem that has that is very old and that has several viewpoints, and it appear in mathematics from different perspectives. Okay, they are pretty natural problem to study for a chosen group. Now a nice exposition of this problem, it may be found in this monograph. It's called Reversibility in Dynamics and Group Theory by Anthony G. O'Farrell and Ian Short. It was published from London Mathematical Society in 2014, and you will find that at the end of every chapter, there are some open questions also. All right, so if you are looking for an open question and you don't know where to look at, and you are interested in group theory or linear algebra, geometry kind of area, then this may be a good book to look into. I mean, even otherwise, you can have a look at this book. If you are interested in, say, complex analysis, you can have a look at this book. They have a chapter where they have discussed reversibility of complex automorphisms. All right. But in spite of many works, a complete and concrete classification of reversible or strongly reversible. So for finite groups, there are many works. So there are this work by Tiep and Zaleski, where they classified finite quasi-simple groups where all elements are real. So finite groups are finite, right? So in finite groups, one can ask even stronger question that to classify. And you know, there are already a huge classification of finite simple groups. So people have listed all the finite simple groups. And there are five volumes of American Mathematical Society monograph where this classification has been given. So for finite group, one asks that, can you classify those finite groups where every element is real? Okay, so that sort of question they have asked and answered more or less satisfactorily. And then people have asked the same question for strongly reversible elements, that you classify finite groups where every element is strongly reversible. And people have done people have done several work in that direction. But for me, I am interested in not in finite groups, I am interested in infinite groups. So for infinite groups, not much is known, I would say. So mostly people have tried to find out the converse question. So on the other day, I actually proved that every strongly reversible or strongly real element is real. Now for infinite group, people have asked the converse question, that when a real element is strongly real. Okay, and there are works of several authors, Ehlers, Sonnenberger, etc., who have answered this question. I would say not from the kind of geometry that we are discussing, but more or less it's a kind of, it's a geometry where algebra plays a role. So it's for, geometric algebra viewpoint, they have answered these questions. Now, a recent work was done by Anupam Singh and Manish Thakur in 2008, where they have proved this result. I would not explain this result, but this result means that in nice linear groups, classical groups over a field, then it follows from the example is the symplectic group. Now, Singh and Thakur, they did not say much about unipotent elements. The concrete classifications for families of groups. All right, to list down the reversible and strongly reversible IISER, that is not known for most of the infinite groups. All right, so there's a blank screen here. I mean, I don't. Okay, so in this talk, what I will do, I will give you classification of reversible and strongly reversible elements in the groups which appear in classical geometries. For example, I already discussed Euclidean geometry on the other sphere. I'll take its automorphism group, and there is another group which is associated to sphere and which extend to the non-Euclidean geometric set. And if they appear in classical geometry, these are reflections. So we have already seen reflections in the
cannot hear properly.
Hello?
Your voice is just crumbling. It is not coming properly. Awasta kete kete jacche, majhe majhe e hoye jacche.
So now I'm audible. So there was some. Okay. So I think now. Okay. Wait a minute. So I am not muted, right? So you can hear me now?
Now we can hear you.
Yeah. So there is this internet issue. I was also observing that my video was lagging. So now I think it is okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So what I was so up to this point you hear, right, what I said. Up to this point, this slide, was it clear?
Yeah, up to this slide is okay.
Okay, so then what I was telling, that I will describe reversible and strongly reversible elements in classical groups. But before that description, I will go back to basics and I will tell you how, this order two elements appear in classical geometries. So we will again go back to the Euclidean setting to begin with. On the other day, we discussed Euclidean two space. So similarly, we can have Euclidean n space, which is Rn equipped with the same positive definite metric that I described on the other class. So that's the model for the Euclidean n space. Now there, on the other day, we have seen that we had this reflection in a line, that z goes to z bar, right? I mean, that was a reflection in a line. So now we can generalize that reflection to n dimension. And here the lines has to be replaced by hyperplanes of the form, so hyperplanes where we fix a point A and we pick up a scalar T. Then take all vectors whose inner product with A is equal to T. So that gives you a hyperplane in the Euclidean N space. And every point on this hyperplane satisfies this inner product condition, that if you take the inner product of the vector A with the vector X minus TA, then it is zero. So to begin with, we assume that the vector A has norm 1. All right. And as soon as you have this hyperplane, this defines a reflection in the hyperplane. It has a nice formula by which I have expressed in the slide by rho t. Now, if you compute or if you observe this expression closely, you will see that this function rho t that fixes every point on the hyperplane. It is an isometry of the Euclidean N space. You can check it by hand. And the square of rho t is identity. All right. So these are the properties of the reflection of this transformation that we obtained here. Now, when t equal to 0, you get the most common reflection, which is the generalization of complex conjugation to n dimension. All right. So these are, you see, these are reflections and order 2 elements of the Euclidean n space. And right now, we will show you a result which states that you take any isometry of the Euclidean n space, then it is a composition of at most n plus 1 reflections in hyperplanes. And the proof is pretty easy. So you start with an isometry. Okay, you fix a base point x naught, which is just the image of your origin under phi. And then you define rho naught to be identity if x naught is 0. Otherwise, you take rho naught to be the reflection in that plane with center x naught by mod x naught and radius, I mean radius or maybe, you know, that inner, that scalar, which is associated to the hyperplane as mod x naught by 2. Okay, then your image of, you know, if you compose rho naught and phi, it will fix origin. And accordingly, it will be, because rho naught is an isometry and your phi is an isometry, so composition of two isometries is an isometry. So rho naught compose phi will be an element in the n-dimensional orthogonal group. And then it's a standard result in linear algebra that every element in the n-dimensional orthogonal group can be written as a product of at most n reflections. So that gives you the proof that every isometry of the Euclidean n space is a composition of at most n plus 1 reflections in hyperplanes. So here you see I have two groups. One is the orthogonal group On, which you can think of the group of rotations of the n minus 1 sphere. And you have the group of isometries of the Euclidean n space. And for both groups, an element is a product of at most n plus 1 reflections. Now, in my original language, every reflection is order 2 elements, so it's an involution. So every isometry of the Euclidean n space or the spherical n space is a product of involutions. All right. So now it's a natural question. What is the minimum number of involutions that is needed to express an element, as a product of some involutions, right? So this is where the question that I have raised at the beginning of this talk comes into picture. Now I will come back to, complex plane for the moment, and I would recall this picture, which you might have seen, for example, if you, which complex analysis book you followed, whatever book you followed, whether Alfors or Conway, this picture is there. So this represents a transformation of the complex plane where you first choose a circle C, and then you define this transformation sigma such that if you call X prime as the image of sigma, then that image of sigma satisfy this identity that you take the ratio of sigma X to A by the radius of the circle that is equal to the radius of the circle and the, by mod of X minus A, right? So this function sigma defines again an order 2 element which fixes pointwise every point on this circle, takes the inside of the circle to the outside and take the outside into the inside. All right. So this sort of transformation is called an inversion of the complex plane. Now, this construction can also be generalized in arbitrary dimension. So you take a n-dimensional sphere with center P and radius R. You take the sphere in Euclidean n plus 1 space. All right, then, so here my sphere is just this circle, an instead of Euclidean ones, Euclidean n plus one space, I have taken the Euclidean plane, which is identified with the complex plane. And this is the usual construction that you do this is especially you do when you learn cross ratio in complex analysis, right? So we are now generalizing this prototype to arbitrary n space. So now you define inversion in the n dimensional sphere to be so now here you note that this inversion is not defined at the center. All right. So at the center, we don't define the inversion. But similarly, here also, we are not defining the inversion at the center. So other than the center at every other point of the Euclidean n plus one space, you define it as the function x star, where px x star lie on the ray emanating from p, and the distance from x to p and x star to p, if you product them, if you take their product, that will be equal to the radius square. All right. So it satisfies the ratio that I have shown you in the previous slide. Now, this defines an inversion in the n-dimensional sphere. And you can check from this formula that sigma pr, it will fix every point on the n-dimensional sphere. All right. Now, we have not defined it at the point P. Now, to do that, you can adjoin the point infinity and you can take the extended Euclidean space. All right, so you take the one point compactification of the Euclidean n plus one space. You can continuously extend this definition to the n plus one dimensional compactification of the Euclidean space, now which is a sphere of dimension n plus one, right? So originally I defined an inversion in the n sphere and I considered it as a function of the punctured Euclidean n plus one space. Now just adjoin infinity and extend it to the whole n plus one sphere. All right. So this is the definition of the inversion, and the inversion fixes the n sphere and interchange the components. So it is like a reflection in the n dimensional sphere. So if instead of, so for example, in the Euclidean n plus one space, you consider the hyperplanes. When you adjoin infinity, the Euclidean n plus one space becomes n plus one dimensional sphere and the hyperplane becomes a n dimensional sphere. So essentially, the original reflection that we started with, that is a special case of this inversion when you look at it from the infinity. All right. So now, so the reflections are special case of inversions. So the inversions are, you can think of inversion as generalized reflections in the sphere. Okay. So you take a n-dimensional sphere, then you can define inversions or reflections in all n minus one or in all hyperspheres, right? So this is what we are doing here. Now, inversions have nice properties. All right. So what are those properties? That it preserves the spheres. That means if you come down from infinity and you are on the plane, then inversions will map the k-dimensional planes through P onto k-dimensional plane. It will map k-dimensional planes, which does not pass through P, to k-dimensional spheres through P. And similarly, it maps sphere through P onto plane not containing P, and k-dimensional sphere, which does not pass through P, onto k-dimensional sphere, which is again does not goes through P. So this is a detailed account of how it behaves on hyperplanes and spheres. But if you think of the compactification of the Euclidean n plus one space as n plus one dimensional spheres, then you can immediately say that an inversion maps a sphere, an n-dimensional sphere in En plus one hat onto an n-dimensional sphere in En plus 1 hat. It is something like this picture where you do it on the Riemann sphere. Now on the Riemann sphere, you take any circle, which can be a line on the complex plane or a round circle. It will map onto a circle on the Riemann sphere. Again, which can be a line on the complex plane or a circle on the complex plane. All right. So this is a special property of the inversion. And this property essentially define the geometric usefulness of inversions. Now, here the proof of this result is pretty straightforward. So I will do it here. So you recall that the similarity group of the Euclidean n plus 1 space acts transitively on the set of all k planes and k spheres of the Euclidean n plus 1 space. I did not state this result in the other class, but I demonstrated it for E2, and I think I mentioned that it holds for arbitrary dimension also. Now, you without loss of generality, you change your viewpoint and you assume the center to be 0 and radius to be 1. So you take the unit sphere, or take the inversion in the unit sphere. So if you prove it for this inversion in the unit sphere, you prove it for everything else, because the arbitrary inversion are just a conjugation of the inversion sigma by a similarity transformations, and similarity transformation also preserves the spheres in En plus 1 hat. Now, you take the general equation of a plane or a sphere which is given by 1 and plug in the value of the sigma there. You will see that you will get another expression of this type, and that gives the proof. All right. Now here are some remarks which I have written. You can ignore the remark at the moment. It's just to explain. When this equation represents a sphere and when it represents a plane. So that does not matter at the moment. You plug in whatever the value of A, it will always give you back an expression of this type, and that proves the result. So inversion preserves hyperspheres in a n plus 1 dimensional sphere. All right. So now, defining inversion, I claimed that the one-point compactification of the Euclidean n space is sphere. Now, here is a proof of that fact using stereographic projection. All right. Now, stereographic projections are nothing but a special case of inversions in the n plus 1 dimensional sphere that maps the sphere minus a point to the n-dimensional plane. All right. Now, a map of the n plus 1 dimensional sphere is called conformal if it preserves angle between two differentiable curves. So on the differentiable curves, you can draw tangents and you take the angle between the tangents. So this, if a transformation preserves that angle, it calls conformal. Now it is a fact that every inversion is conformal. That means it's angle preserving. And you take the group that is generated by all inversions of the n plus one dimensional sphere. Then that group, which I denote it by m n plus one, it is called the Mobius group. So this is the group of all conformal diffeomorphisms of the sphere. So again, I have a group, nice group generated by involutions. And if you restrict it to the case when n equal to 1, then you get back your complex plane. And what is this group M2? So this is a very familiar group to us. This is the group of all Mobius transformations. So the group of all conformal diffeomorphisms of S2 can be identified with the group of all complex Mobius transformations. All right. So here I will sketch the proof again, but I must say here that this result, you cannot expect it to be hold true for higher dimensional n, but in two dimension or in low dimension is very specific, and that's why there are several geometric structures that is available in dimension two. All right, so now how to see this. So here I define a group which is generated by set of all inversions in, for the moment, for me it is S2. So for n equal to 1 means I am taking S2, which is identified with the extended complex plane. And on the right hand side, I have a group of linear fractional transformations for the complex plane. Now how to identify these two groups? So here is a quick proof. So first of all, you write down, so for example, you see I written here an expression for the inversion. You see this one where my little hand is. This is the expression for an inversion in Rn plus 1. Now in the complex coordinate, you retain the same sort of expression and you write it as sigma ar. But in complex coordinate, you know that your mod of z can be written as zz bar. So that will make this expression, that will transfer your previous expression to this one. Okay. Now, these are all linear fractional transformations. So the inversions are special types of linear fractional transformations. And hence, the group that they will generate will be contained in the group which is on the right-hand side, which I have written as M plus disjoint union with M minus. Now, how to show the reverse inclusion? So to do that, you first observe the following. You take the translation. Then a translation on the complex plane can be written as a composition of two reflections, where the lines of reflections are parallel and it is orthogonal to the vector, to the translational vector. All right. And you choose the distance between two lines to be a by 2. So then what you do, you take a point, you first reflect it through L, it comes to, you know, you first reflect it to L, so you have two lines here. You first reflect it and then take another reflections, right? So every time you are taking composition of these two reflections, you are translating your point by a vector A. So this proves that a translation is the composition of two reflections in lines. Similarly, this, the second fact, I have already discussed it in the other day, that a rotation, you can think of it as a composition of two reflections also. So this also proves actually that you take the Euclidean isometries, you can express them as product of two reflections, right? So the first, in the first case, you express every translation as a product of two reflections. And in the second case, you express every rotation as a product of two reflections. Now take any arbitrary Euclidean isometry of dimension 2. I proved on the other day that it is either a rotation, if it is orientation preserving, it is either a rotation or a translation. So this proves that, in particular, that every isometry of E2 is a product of two reflections, but this will be used for us. This will be useful for us. Now, the second fact that you should observe, that one should observe, is that the group M2 acts transitively on the Riemann sphere. Now, you see the translations are transitive on the complex plane. They are, you can translate points in all directions. And the inversion in the unit circle, or Z goes to 1 by Z bar, that will carry 0 to infinity. You take the inversion in the unit circle, 0 is the center of the unit circle, so it will carry 0 to infinity. So any point of C hat can be mapped by an inversion to another point. So M2 acts transitively on C hat. All right. So now what is the stabilizer subgroup of infinity under m plus. So you can so on the right hand side, this is a group action by Mobius transformation. Z goes to Az plus B by Cz plus D. So this is a transformation of the Riemann sphere. Now, what are the transformations that fixes infinity? You can divide the numerator and the denominator by Z. That will give you the answer. All right. So, well, so I skipped one step here. So there are two more transformations that I should have expressed as a product of two reflections. One of the similarity transformation of the stretches, you can express them as a composition of two inversions, one in the unit circle, another in the circle with center origin and radius root r. And this proves that you take any transformation of the form Z goes to Az plus B, where A, B are complex number, it can be expressed as a product of inversions. So in other words, the orientation preserving similarities of the Euclidean two space is contained in the Mobius group, because you can express them as a product of inversions. Now you observe that the group M2 acts transitively on C hat, and on the right hand side, you look at the stabilizer subgroup of infinity. So that will turn out to be the orientation preserving similarities of E2, and we have already seen that it is contained in the Mobius group. All right. So now, since by the transitivity property, for all Z in C hat, there exists an element in M2 which maps infinity to Z, you take the conjugate of the similarity group by F. That will give you another group MZ plus, which will contain in the Mobius group. And you take the union of all such groups, they will contain in the Mobius group. So now every element, every linear fractional transformation has a fixed point on C hat. So the group of all complex linear orientation preserving complex linear fractionals will contain in the Mobius group. All right. And since the group generated by M plus and the Z goes to Z bar is equal to G, which is the group on the right hand side, which I wrote here. So you take this M plus, compose it with Z goes to Z bar. That gives you this group G. So, and we already proved that M plus is contained in M2 and Z goes to Z bar. That's a inversion. That's a special case of inversion. So this whole right hand side is contained in left hand side. And that proves the equality. So this proves that the group of all linear fractional transformations of the complex of the Riemann sphere to the group of all Mobius transformation of the Riemann sphere, which is the group generated by inversions. All right. So we proved a nice result where we know that you take the Riemann sphere, two-dimensional sphere, which is the extended complex plane. Now you know what are the group of conformal diffeomorphisms of the two spheres. Okay. And when we started with inversions, but in the two-dimensional case, that turns out to be very familiar object to us. Okay, so this completes the proof. Now it's an exercise in any standard complex analysis book that a Mobius transformation keeps the real line invariant if and only if the coefficients belongs to the real line. Okay. And this is the starting point of something that I will describe now. So which is the hyperbolic plane? So you consider the complex upper half plane. Okay, you take that. Okay, so before I start this, is there any question of whatever I have said so far?
Sir, can we write the inverse function in terms of inversions?
In terms of?
Inversions, this.
Say it again, say the question again. Which transformation you are trying to write?
Z inverse, Z to Z inverse.
Okay, so Z to Z inverse, that means Z goes to 1 by Z.
Yeah.
So that's not an inversion, but it is a product of two inversions, and it's an exercise for you to find out. It's very obvious, no? You just take Z goes to 1 by Z bar, compose it with Z goes to Z bar. That will give you your Z goes to 1 by Z.
Okay, so I have go through the Z bar. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, what are the inversions? They are either reflections in lines or reflections in circles. Z goes to 1 by Z bar is a reflection in a circle, then you compose it with the reflection in the line.
Fine.
Okay. So, thank you for asking questions. So, is there any more questions? Okay. So, if there is no more questions, then let me describe what is a hyperbolic plane. So, what I am doing now, I am essentially building up familiarity with the basic objects where we will study reversibility. Now, yeah, so because this is a kind of, expository lecture, so I am including detail. Now, for experts, some of you may know all these things, but I hope those who don't know, they are getting something out of it. So now consider the hyperbolic plane. Consider the complex upper half plane. The complex upper half plane, take the whole complex number whose imaginary part is positive. And then on the complex upper half plane, you scale the Euclidean distance by the imaginary part of Z. So what does it mean? So DS2 means this is a length metric. That means you take any two points on the complex upper half plane. If you want to measure the length of that curve, you can integrate that curve with respect to this length, infinitesimal length function. Now, this gives a metric on the hyperbolic plane. So you take two points, take all possible curves between the two points, find out their lengths, take the infimum of all those lengths. You define that to be the distance between X and Y. So that's a metric. This exercise that's a metric in the usual metric space sense, and hence the complex upper half plane equipped with this metric is a metric space, and we call it as the upper half space model or upper half plane model of the hyperbolic plane. And the boundary of this hyperbolic plane is a real line, of course. I mean, H2 is the boundary real line. But there we also add one point, infinity somewhere. Now, when I added that, it will be clear to you in a few moments. Now, what are the isometries? Isometry means which will preserve this metric. Now, computing isometries with respect to the metric D may be a daunting task. So what you do, you just replace DS2 by, say, D phi z by imaginary of phi z, where phi is a transformation, and see whether it is equal to the mod dz by imaginary z or not. Now, if you do that, you will observe that these are all isometries of the hyperbolic plane. So, for example, this transformation, z goes to az, where a is a real number, z the translations, and this inversion. Okay, I would say rotatory inversion. Okay, so these are all isometries. If you compose all of them, it is not difficult to prove that the isometric group of the hyperbolic plane is equal to the subgroup of the Mobius transformations where coefficients are real number. And it has two components. On one component, AD minus BC is positive, and the other component is negative. Now, what is AD minus BC? If you consider the coefficient matrix, you see that it is the determinant of the coefficient matrix. So that means there is some matrix group that is involved here, and that group is denoted. So you take the 2 by 2 matrices over the real number with determinant 1, then take modulo plus minus identity. So that is identified with the group of orientation preserving isometries of the hyperbolic plane. In other words, the group SL2R acts by orientation preserving isometries via these transformations. And it is easy to check that this transformation is transitive. You know, it's the same proof, like the Euclidean case. You can just modify it slightly. You can prove that this action is transitive. So in other words, we get a nice two-dimensional geometric space where we have a matrix group, which is very simple looking, is acting transitively. Now, this is one description of the hyperbolic plane. Now we will have another description, and this is the description that I will use to describe the reversible elements. So here I will describe it for arbitrary n, because my result for reversibility is for arbitrary dimension, but then I will restrict over it over to dimension 2 so that you get a feeling of what is this all about. So this is the linear model for the hyperbolic plane. So for that, you take a group which is very familiar to people in general relativity. So you take the n plus 1 dimensional affine space Rn plus 1, equip it with the inner product. So the Euclidean inner product consists of x1, y1 up to xn plus 1, yn plus 1, where all the sign are plus in between. But here you take x1, y1 up to xn, yn, just the Euclidean inner product, and then instead of plus, you add one minus. In other words, you know that an inner product can be expressed by a matrix. So in the Euclidean case, the identity matrix gives you the Euclidean inner product. But here, you just replace one element, that is the inner product that you can take. Now here I have chosen this matrix where the first n diagonal entries are 1 and the last one is minus 1. And it is called a real inner product of signature n, 1. Now, if you know that theory of Sylvester's, or you know the Sylvester's law of inertia, you will see that this matrix J, I mean, if you replace any of this, if you replace it by another diagonal matrix where you choose your minus 1 in any of the diagonal and fill up the rest by plus 1, then these two inner products are equivalent to each other, so that will not change my geometry. All right. Now, the norm of x is, as usual, you take the square root of the inner product of x with itself, and then this inner product divides Rn plus 1 into three subsets. One set, the set of all vectors which has positive inner positive length, set of all vectors which has negative length, and the set of all vectors which has zero length. So this is considerably different from the Euclidean plane where V0 is, zero, a singleton set. But here you have a whole subspace, which I will describe shortly. And the isometric group of Rn plus 1 with respect to this inner product is denoted by On, 1. It is called the Lorentz orthogonal group. And it is given by the n plus 1 by n plus 1 matrices, such that A transpose J, A equal to J. So it's is the condition that they satisfy. Now, you choose a basis, it is Lorentz orthonormal. If it satisfies, you take E1 up to En plus 1. So you take the first n basis elements as of norm 1 and the last one of norm minus 1, and they're mutually orthogonal to each other. Then, just like we have a theorem for compact orthogonal group, here also you have a similar theorem that an element belongs to the Lorentz orthonormal group if and only if it preserves the inner product or the rows and the columns of the corresponding matrix form an Lorentz orthonormal basis. Not for ON, comma 1, but for RN plus 1. Okay, so it's the typo here. So they form a Lorentz orthonormal basis for the underlying space, which is RN, comma 1. I have written at the top. All right. So now what is the hyperbolic plane? So again, now I come back to dimension 3. I do it for dimension 3, but the same construction is valid for dimension n also. But because I have described hyperbolic plane, I will now restrict it to dimension n2, which is n equal to 1. N equal to 1, right? Yeah, n equal to 1. No, sorry, n equal to 2 in this case. Yeah, so n equal to 2. But the same construction is, you just mimic it for arbitrary n, that will give you the model for the hyperbolic n space. Now, what happened that you have this inner product, x, y, you have this, decomposition of the underlying vector space by, positive vectors, negative vectors, and null vectors, which is usually called space-like, light-like, time-like, all right? Then you choose your hyperbolic plane, the model for the hyperbolic plane, as the vectors which has norm minus 1. Okay, so this gives you two disjoint components. Now I choose one of the components where x3 is positive. All right, now you take any two points on this strange looking space. All right, so there is a unique real number eta that is related to the inner product by this formula. And the distance between x and y is this, hyperbolic angle eta. Okay, and the hyperbolic line of h2 is just a intersection of a two-dimensional 1,1 subspace with the R2,1. Now, if you draw a picture, then this is the picture in dimension 2. So you have a three-dimensional space R2,1, x1, x2, x3. Now take the vectors where norm is minus 1. Now it has two components, one in the upper half hyperboloid and the lower half hyperboloid. But we want to take only one hyperboloid, so we choose the hyperboloid where x3 is always positive. Now there is, this is a hyperboloid. This is a space. This is a space in, this is a sort of two-dimensional subspace in a three-dimensional space. And it is not clear to us how it looks like. Now here is a projection which is somewhat like stereographic projection. So what you do in stereographic projection, you have the north pole, then you draw a line from the north pole which hits your sphere at exactly one point and then hits the plane at exactly one point. The same thing you do here. But here, instead of north pole, what you do, you choose the pole in the other hyperboloid, which is minus E3. From there, you draw a line through the x1, x2 plane, which will hit your upper half hyperboloid at exactly one point zeta. Now, you do it in other words, you take a point on the upper half hyperboloid, then join it by line, the straight line, to the point E3 in the lower half hyperboloid. Okay, so this will project every point in the upper half hyperboloid to a point X in the unit disk on the X1, X2 plane. All right, so that, in other words, this identifies the upper half hyperboloid, which is strange looking, to a very familiar object, which is the unit disk on x1, x2 plane. Okay, and the boundary, which is the vectors where length is zero, it identifies it with the boundary of the disk. And accordingly, it transfer the metric to this nice metric, which is familiar looking. All right, and the geodesic or a line in this metric is a distance preserving curve on the disk. Now recall that on the Euclidean N space, on the other day I described that, maybe I am not described, but the geodesic or the straight lines, they preserve the distance. That means you take any two points, then the distance is minimum along the straight lines. The same thing happened here. So there are geodesics. So this intersection of R1, 1 with the hyperboloid, they maps onto geodesics of the hyperbolic disk, which is obtained by this identification. All right. Now here is a picture for me for the hyperbolic disk. All right. So if you do all these things, you will see that the geodesics are the semicircles, which are orthogonal to the boundary circle. So you take any semicircle which is orthogonal to the boundary circle of the disk, that is a geodesic of the hyperbolic plane. That means you take any two points on these lines, the distance is minimum. All right, and three line when they intersect, this yellow region, that's a hyperbolic triangle, and it's a remarkable fact which is pretty different from Euclidean geometry, that the sum of angles of a hyperbolic triangle is always less than pi, less than 180 degree. And you take a line L and a point P outside the given line, there are more than one line, which one geodesic, which passes through P, but which does not intersect L. In other words, when two lines or two geodesics don't intersect, you can call them parallel. So given a line L and a point outside the given line, there are infinitely many lines in the hyperbolic plane which are parallel to L. So this is very much different from the Euclidean picture, where you have a line and you have a point outside the line, and there is a unique line passing through the point which is parallel to the given line. Okay, so this is a model for non-Euclidean geometry, and here I have I'm taking this picture from website, and this is a picture by snap is based on the picture by Dutch artist, very famous Dutch artist, I have forgot the name, but this is a very famous picture. So this gives you a tessellation of the hyperbolic disk by hyperbolic triangles. Now, one thing I must mention here, that if you look at these triangles, you see this is a triangle, see my little hand, okay, so one thing I have not said yet, that how this disk model is identified with the this is by, again, by a well-known Mobius transformation. So you know that there is a Mobius transformation, Z goes to Z minus I by Z plus I, that is a 1-1 onto both sided, you can say, holomorphic map from the complex upper half plane to the unit disk. So they identify this upper half space model with the disk model, the one which I have written. And hence, when you talk about the boundary of the hyperbolic two space in the upper half space, then you identify the boundary with the circle. And what is the boundary of the complex upper half space? It's real line, and you have another point somewhere, which is infinity, which makes it a circle. R union infinity there. All right. So now look at this picture. So here are these nice triangles, right? So you see these two triangle, the triangle where my little hand is, and this small little triangle, and maybe this small little triangle. So these three triangle, they have the same angle. All right. So they are congruent to each other. So this is a kind of another difference between Euclidean and hyperbolic geometry. In Euclidean geometry, when you have two congruent triangles, you can superimpose one onto the other so that they are identical. In hyperbolic geometry, you also do that, but with the hyperbolic eye, with our with the eye, we difference between, where with our usual eye, when we differentiate between bigger and smaller, in hyperbolic geometry, a bigger triangle like this can be congruent to a smaller triangle. That means there is an isometry that maps this bigger triangle to this smaller triangle. Okay, and this makes sense because unlike Euclidean geometry, where you have only one point outside Euclidean plane, here you have a whole one parameter family of infinity. So this boundary, the metric becomes infinity here. So like, it's like, you know, when you take two parallel lines of the Euclidean plane, they meet somewhere, right? We think they meet somewhere, they meet at infinity. Now here, instead of one infinity, you have a whole circle of infinity. So when you, at the center, you are at the land, and when something goes towards infinity, it becomes smaller and smaller, right? So it's sort of resemble that philosophy. It is indeed, I mean, you can find one concrete isometry that will map this small triangle to this relatively bigger looking triangle. But from the in the hyperbolic plane, if you sit in the hyperbolic plane, there is no difference between these two. All right. Now, what about classification of isometries? So we saw that we can classify our isometries of the Euclidean plane in the previous lecture as rotations, translations, and reflections, glide reflections. Now, what sort of classification is possible here? For that, I will go back to my upper space model. I will take the Mobius transformation. And first, you observe that you take any Mobius transformation, it has at most two fixed points. Now, this gives you a quadratic equation 1. Now, there are several cases that both roots of 1 are real and distinct. One root has multiplicity 2, or it has complex conjugate roots. Depending on that, your number of fixed points is either 1 or 2. Now, this is a general definition. Now, I have written this definition in dimension 2, but I would like to emphasize here that the dimension is true in this definition is true in any dimension. And one reason this definition is true is the theorem that Professor Satyadeo mentioned in one of his lectures, which is called Brouwer's fixed point theorem. So you have this closed disk. Now, by the Brouwer's fixed point theorem, any continuous automorphism of the disk has a fixed point. And with some little bit more work, you can prove that the fixed point can either be inside the hyperbolic plane, or if there is no fixed point inside, on the boundary, there can be at most two fixed points. So that gives you the same definition in arbitrary dimension also, that an isometry of the hyperbolic space, you can take it as an arbitrary n-dimensional space as elliptic if it has a fixed point on the hyperbolic plane. It is parabolic if it has no fixed point on the hyperbolic plane and a unique fixed point on the boundary. It is hyperbolic if it has no fixed point on the hyperbolic disk, but it has exactly two fixed points on the boundary. In this dimension, it is very easy to see. You just, you know, use this polynomial equation and just see that this holds true. Okay, so now depending on these three cases, you compute the discriminant. So in case you have both roots are real and distinct, then your discriminant is negative. Accordingly, mod of a plus d is less than 2. And that case, it is, elliptic. All right. And similarly, when you have a unique root, it is mod a plus 2 is equal to 2. And when it's hyperbolic, that means 3. The mod a plus 2 is greater than 2. So this gives you this nice classification of isometries of the hyperbolic plane, that you take any isometry of the hyperbolic plane, then a is elliptic if and only if the trace of the corresponding matrix is less than 2. It is parabolic if and only if the trace of the corresponding matrix is equal to 2. It is hyperbolic if and only if the trace of the corresponding matrix is greater than 2. Now, this is a typical classification in dimension 2, where you relate the behavior of an isometry, which we have classified based on their fixed points to their algebraic data, like the trace. And you know that the trace is a conjugacy invariant of any linear matrix. So, and A, B, C, D is a matrix. So trace is a conjugacy invariant for that. So essentially, this gives you a conjugacy classification in SL2R or PSL2R. So this is another instance where geometric study leads to a understanding of the internal structure of the group, or in other way around, or in another way around, that if you take the linear algebraic or the algebraic data of a group, that gives you geometric data if somebody gives you a 2x2 matrix over real number and determinant 1 matrix, then just by looking at the algebraic data, you have an idea how the corresponding isometry moves on the hyperbolic plane. So this is again in line of Klein's philosophy, where the structure of the group helps you to understand the movement of the corresponding automorphism in the geometry. All right. So this is a result that I want to mention in order to give you the connection between groups and geometry. Now, we have seen Euclidean plane geometry, we have seen hyperbolic plane geometry, and we have the usual round earth. All right. So in the earth, the lines with respect to the spherical metric are great circles, and you take any surface in the universe, you can draw a triangle on it. And just by looking at the triangle, you can see what sort of geometry it has. If the triangles are flat, where some of the angles are equal to pi, then the surface is flat, is locally isometric to Euclidean plane. If the triangles are a little bit thicker, where some of the angles are greater than pi, then you can say that the surface is spherical. And if the triangles are thin, that means the sum of the angles of a triangle is less than pi, then the surface is hyperbolic. And all you take all nice surfaces, like compact connected surfaces, they are locally modeled on one of these three structures. And not only that, this leads to something more. Peter Hyacinski, I think he described the so-called cat spaces. So there, these sort of comparison techniques, that's by looking at that, you have a model space, these are the model spaces. Now you compare any arbitrary metric spaces with one of these model spaces, and you try to understand the geometry in the arbitrary metric spaces, which is similar to the geometry in these model spaces, right? So this comparison technique, so these three geometries gives rise to the comparison technique to study more general metric spaces in mathematics. And where, again, I mean, you have the groups, isometric groups, which play a crucial role in the understanding also. But I will not mention that. I will now come back. What happened? Okay. So I will now come back to my main slide.
Someone is presenting.
Yeah. So that's why.
So I can. Who is the person? Please stop sharing.
Okay. Devidas Chaturaj is asking some questions, I think.
Okay. Please share again. Your slide.
Sure.
Please share again.
Me? Maybe
yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So now I will come back. Okay. So maybe let me answer the question first.
Yes, sir. What is your question, Professor Devidas Chaturaj? Please ask the question. Devidas Babu, apnar mute kora ache. If you want to ask questions, please unmute.
Maybe you can also unmute, no? From here.
Bablu, can you unmute him?
No, not possible from this end.
I see.
So let us proceed.
So, let us see. Just
continue. It is also a good place because and this was the sort of, you know, exposure to basic materials. So if there is any further questions, I will be happy to answer before I proceed.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, sure.
Sir, in the Euclidean geometry, we know the similar triangle both sides are equal and the angle are equal. So,
right.
So in hyperbolic geometry, what is the main difference for similar triangle?
Okay, so this is the question that I was trying to mention here in this picture. So in Euclidean geometry, you have the notion of congruent triangle and you have the notion of similar triangle. So two triangles are congruent if, you know, they have the same side length, etc. So you can essentially map one triangle onto the other. And they are similar if, so a small triangle can be similar to a bigger triangle. If they have, say, the same angle, so there are these rules, right? SAS, side angle, side and angle, side, angle, etc. Now, in hyperbolic geometry, there is no notion of similar triangle. So, either two triangles are congruent to each other or they are not. So, there is no notion of similarity. In other words, in hyperbolic geometry, similarity and congruence, they are equivalent. All right. So like this big triangle, I mean, they have the same sort of angles that is equal to this small triangle. So, that means two triangles are similar if and only if they are congruent. That means they have the same angles and that they have the same side lengths. All right. So, like in the Euclidean geometry, we have, if you think in terms of group theoretic terms, in the Euclidean geometry, you have the isometric group, and then you scale the isometric group by non-negative real numbers. That gives you the similarity group, which I have described today. But in hyperbolic geometry, there is no similarity group. It's only the isometric group. Okay. So that's what I was trying to make here, bigger triangles can be congruent to smaller triangles. That's what I was trying to point out here.
Sir, so in this picture, we see that there are different type of triangles, but actually they are same size. This is like
they are congruent to each other. They are isometric. Okay. I mean, okay. The isometric which map one, maybe not this one.
Not
the
middle
one. One is different, but this one, say the one where my little hand is, that one and this small one. Okay, so there is an isometry which will map one to the other. Okay. So
this is like eye illusion.
You see, I mean, it depends on where your eye is. When you look at the hyperbolic disk from the Euclidean plane, it's an eye illusion. But suppose you are sitting inside the hyperbolic plane, then suppose you are sitting here, then what is surrounding you? That's the infinite circle, right? So that's infinite. That's like a sky, right? Big sky. So when this triangle, with a transformation, suppose you see the triangle here, then you map it towards the infinity, then when you fly a kite, the more it goes away from you, it becomes smaller and smaller, right? It's similar picture in the hyperbolic plane.
Yeah.
So the more it goes near infinity, it looks smaller and smaller, but it is actually congruent to the original big shape that you saw at the beginning. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So maybe since you have raised this point, maybe may I take a digression, if you allow me. Okay, so let me stop sharing. And what you are saying as illusion, actually you can play lots of so it depends on what is where you are sitting, right? So we are, our world is Euclidean, so we see everything from the Euclidean perspective. Now, if you want to see everything from the hyperbolic perspective, then you have to choose your piece of paper as hyperbolic. All right. And to do that, I will like to draw your attention to this. I like this website actually, and I have, and wherever I give a lecture, I normally mention about this website. So if you look at this website, it's called Non-Euclid. Okay, you search on Google as Non-Euclid, they will give you this website. Now there is this interactive Java software. So it's a this white color circle disk. It's a hyperbolic disk. And there with the computer, you can move your point and you can draw whatever you want to draw. So for example, I'm drawing here a line segment. So I take a line here and you see this is a line segment from, okay. And then I draw another line segment. And so this is my triangle. Okay, and then you can ask for measuring angles. You see, it will give you the angle between these three points. Okay, somehow it is not giving. Maybe I have to move a point here somewhere. Okay, so I take a point here. All right, so now you measure the angle in these three points. Okay, you see this is giving you this angle ABC. Okay, ABC. And then similarly, you can measure the angle CBA and so on so forth. Okay, so this way, you can actually play with this software and you can visualize yourself how things are different in Euclidean geometry or from hyperbolic geometry. Okay, so there are several, inbuilt geometric objects here also, like this is an isosceles triangle, two sides are equal, and you can try to see what are the isometric types of this triangle. So this is a small game that one may like to play when they have some spare time. So you just go to Google and search non-Euclid, okay? So that will give you this website. Okay, you click there and it will take you to this website. So they also have some sort of animation where you see, as your point moves, you see how the shapes are changing. All right. So this will also give you an idea how things are different in hyperbolic geometry. Okay. So with this, is there any more questions?
I just want to ask or clarify.
Yeah.
What will be the conjugacy classes or stabilizers if the groups are normal subgroup? It will be trivial.
Say it again.
If the groups are normal subgroup, then.
Okay. So in the normal subgroup. Normal subgroup means. So you were saying that conjugacy classes will be trivial or not in a normal I think these isometric groups are simple groups. So there is no normal subgroups here.
So the condition that Gx, G inverse like that, G equal to G.
Yeah.
So that condition will be automatically hold there, no? For normal subgroups.
Yeah, yeah. So these groups are simply groups. So there is no normal subgroup. So the only normal plus minus identity. All right. So.
Yeah.
So for subgroup, non-trivial normal subgroup of PSL2R or isometric.
Okay.
But if suppose you have a group and you have a normal subgroup, then Yeah, then what are the conjugacy classes in the normal?
Yeah. That is my question.
Yeah. So there, I mean, you have to see. For example, I'm giving you just one example. For example, if you take this Euclidean isometric, all right, then the identity component. Okay, so that is a normal subgroup, isn't it? Yeah. But I think one has to see what are the.
Yeah. Okay. You have to check it.
Okay, fine. So now I will come back to my original problem that I started with about classifying reversible elements in classical geometries. Now, by classical geometry, I mean one of these three types, but in arbitrary dimension. All right. Now, the isometric groups are essentially generalization of these groups. You have seen two of them, and the other one for the sphere, this is the orthogonal group, which is the isometric group of the n sphere. Now, if you start with the n-dimensional orthogonal group, which is O(n), it's a result of Unenberger, but Unenberger proved it for orthogonal groups over arbitrary fields. But even otherwise, in the case of the spherical isometric group, you can do it in a more easy way just by using the conjugacy classification in O(n), that every element in the n-dimensional orthogonal group is strongly reversible. But this is not the case for SON, as we have already mentioned, that this, if the rotation G, they can get the result. So the characteristic person that is on or if n is equivalent to 2 mod 4, then an orthogonal decomposition of the underlying space decomposes it in itself into orthogonally indecomposable subspaces, which should contain an odd dimensional sum. So that means you can decompose Rn into direct sum of subspaces which cannot be decomposed further. So that means every sum should be invariant under T, and there is no other T invariant subspace contained in one each of the sums. Okay, so that means that's indecomposability means, and one of the sums should be odd dimensional. So this classifies strongly reversible element in SON. And one can also prove that an element in SON is reversible if and only if it is strongly reversible. You can prove it independently, or it also follows from this work by Singh and Thakur. And that gives you complete classification of reversible and strongly reversible elements in SON. All right. So this takes care of the spherical space form. Now you consider the Euclidean space form, so the isometric group of the Euclidean n space, which I have already mentioned to be the semi-direct product of orthogonal group with Rn, and the action is given by x goes to ax plus b. I described it in the other day. Now, it is a theorem. I don't know why no one has proved it before this Ian Short, but this is a theorem of Ian Short around 2008. That every element in the isometric group of En is strongly reversible. That means every element is a product of two involutions. Okay, and what are the involutions? We have already seen they are the reflections of the reflections, right? So every element is a product of two involutions in En. Now, what about the identity component, which is the semi-direct product of Rn with SON? Now, again, short first proof that an element is reversible in this group if and only if it is strongly reversible. Then he classified the strongly reversible element explicitly. So Short proved that you take any orientation preserving isometry of the Euclidean n space. When n is not equal to 0 or 3 mod 4, that then every element in this group is strongly reversible. But when n is equal to 1 mod 4 or 2 mod 4, then the cases become much more subtle, and Short gave conditions for proving when these are strongly reversible. All right. So in other words, classification of reversible and strongly reversible element is completely known in this isometric group of En. Now, what about reversibility in hyperbolic geometry? So we have already seen this model of hyperbolic space and the isometric group as isometric group of this quadratic form is On, 1. Now that upper of hyperboloid that is preserved by two of the components of On, 1, and we denote it by PON, 1. Now it's a classical result that every element in PON, 1 is a product of two involutions. So the full group of isometries, if you also involve orientation reversing isometries, then every element can be expressed as a product of two involutions. But what about strong reversibility in the identity component? That means the component containing orientation preserving isometries of the hyperbolic n space. Now there the cases are much more subtle. So again, you look at the case n equal to 2. So look at this translation. So let's go back to the model of SL2R and look at this translation. Z goes to Z plus 1 and Z goes to Z minus 1. They are inverse to each other. Now look at their action on the boundary. Now you will see that the orientation that this translation gives on the boundary, they are different. And if they are conjugate, then this orientation must be same. So this gives a geometric proof that a translation in PSL2R cannot be conjugate to its inverse in PSL2R. So that means in SO not 2,1, not every element is reversible. So every element cannot be strongly reversible. Now, what about in dimension 3? So this Mobius group that I have described today, so that was a group of conformal automorphism of the sphere. Now there are ways you can extend it to the whole three-dimensional disk, and you can take that disk to be a model of the hyperbolic three space, and you can identify this group of Mobius transformations as the orientation preserving isometries of the hyperbolic three space. Now it's a classical result of Penchel using this identification that every element of PSL2C, or in my model SO03,1, is a product of two involution. So that means the problem of conjugacy, in particular reversibility or strong reversibility, can be very different in different dimensions and in different subgroups of the same group. So even if you suppose you find out reversibility or strong reversibility in a bigger group, you cannot say the same is true in a smaller group. And this is an example of that. So for SO0N,1, one needs to work it out explicitly. And in 2011, I work it out. So every element in SO0N,1 is real if and only if n is equivalent to 0 mod 4 or 3 mod 4. When n is equivalent to 1 mod 4, an element is real if and only if either it is an element with no eigenvalue lambda, or in other words, it is a hyperbolic element, or if it is a parabolic or elliptic element, then it must have an eigenvalue plus 1 or minus 1. And if n equal to 2 mod 4, then it is real if and only if either 1 and 2 here holds with plus 1 omitted. And the third condition is that if it is a elliptic or parabolic, then and it has no eigenvalue minus 1, then it must have a space-like eigenvector V corresponding to the eigenvalue 1. Okay, and it is a fact that in arbitrary dimension, in SO0N,1, if you take an elliptic or parabolic isometry, it must have an eigenvalue 1. So this classifies the reversible elements in SO0N,1, And one can also prove that an element in S1 not n comma 1 is real if and only if it is strongly real. So this theorem also classifies the strongly real elements in S1 not n comma 1. Now I must mention here, around the same time, Ian Short, he also proved the same result. So he, in this paper where he proved his this result, he also has a section on hyperbolic isometries, but the model that he has chosen is different from the model I have chosen here, and his result also has a different flavor. So if you want to look at the result that he has proved, then I recommend to look into the book that I have suggested at the beginning. So there he has proved a version of this result, but using the ball model of the hyperbolic plane. Okay, so now in geometry, of in differential geometry, there are, you know, there is a notion of symmetric spaces, and there are rank one symmetric spaces. Now this hyperbolic real hyperbolic space is one rank one symmetric space of non-compact type. Now there are three more, but two of them has linear isometric groups. Those are the complex hyperbolic space and the quaternionic hyperbolic space. Now in a subsequent works, we have classified reversible and strongly reversible elements for other two linear rank one groups. So for the complex hyperbolic for the isometric group of the complex hyperbolic space, in a joint work with John Parker, we have classified reversible and strongly reversible elements. And in very recently, last year, we have classified in a joint work with Sushil Bhunia, we have classified reversible and strongly reversible elements in the isometric group of the n-dimensional quaternionic hyperbolic space. Now, I don't have much time, but I must say here that the quaternions are one of the four-dimensional real associative division algebra. So it's a theorem, classical theorem, that over real there can be only three real associative division algebras, either the field of real number, field of complex number, or the field of skew field of the quaternions. Now quaternions are non-commutative. Because of this non-commutativity, the kind of linear algebraic machinery you have over complex number does not carry over to the quaternions. For example, over complex number you have eigenvalues, you have a linear transformation. Then every linear transformation, if it has an eigenvalue, that eigenvalue has a unique one-dimensional eigenspace. Now over quaternion, eigenvalues are not unique to a given eigenspace. They appear in similarity classes, and that complicates things. But in this work with Sushil Bhunia, we have somehow been able to avoid that technical difficulty, and we have classified the strongly reversible elements of the quaternionic hyperbolic n space. Now there is one can ask reversibility in an arbitrary Lie group. So I think my time is almost over, but I will take two more minutes just to quickly go through what is here. So what are the classification of reversible and strongly reversible element known for? So these are the groups where the classification is completely known. So the compact groups, orthogonal group, unitary group, and the quaternionic unitary group, which is very recently. You know it for general linear group over real number and complex numbers. You know it for the isometric group of the Euclidean space. You know it for the isometric group of rank one symmetric spaces of non-compact type, where the isometric group was linear. All right. Now one can also ask more generally for arbitrary Lie groups. Now in most of the Lie group it is not known, but in this joint work with Chandan Maiti, we have investigated systematically the reversibility of unipotent elements in a Lie group. And to do that, we introduce an infinitesimal analog of the reversibility using the adjoint map of the Lie group. All right. And we have got some classification for unipotent elements in an arbitrary simple Lie group. And this is the new sort of viewpoint that we have been able to inculcate, that you take the adjoint map from a Lie group to its automorphism group of the Lie algebra, then take the adjoint orbit of a Lie algebra element, and then you call an element as adjoint real if minus x, you take element x from the Lie algebra, you call it adjoint real if minus x belongs to this adjoint orbit. All right, it's similar to the, it's an infinitesimal analog of the classical concept of reality. Similarly, you can define a strongly real element, and then the exponential map maps the infinitesimal real element to the Lie group element, and you know, we have classified unipotent elements in a simple Lie group using this Lie algebra correspondence. So essentially what we have done, we have classified nilpotent elements in the Lie algebra and then projected using the exponential map into the Lie group, so that classify the unipotent element in the semi-simple Lie group. So here is a list of Lie groups where we have classified the reversible unipotent elements in the Lie algebra and hence in the Lie group. So with this, I think I would like to stop here. Yeah. So this is some latest development where, we have done some work. Yeah.
Thank you, Krishnendu, for your nice presentation, and a very, from basic level, you have taken to a very higher level, and your research work also given. And we shall again, I think, in some next program, we will listen about the Lie groups, the results of Lie groups and all these things, because these are also very interesting. These are very, very interesting things. Is there any questions?
I will be happy, yeah.
Yes. Is there any questions from audience, from participants? Any more? Okay, so if not, we thank Krishnendu for giving us time, though he is very busy with another program. So we again thank to Krishnendu for giving this wonderful lecture. Thank you, Krishnendu.
Thank you very much for inviting me here. And as I told, that it was a pleasure to give the lecture in a program of Calcutta Mathematical Society. I would have been much happier if I could have come physically
to Calcutta
Mathematical Society and give this lecture. But I hope someday it will be possible.
Yes. Yeah. Obviously. So
thank you for your attention.
Okay. Thank you. Now, Kaushik, please, if you have any announcement.
Yeah, I think before that, I can see that Poritosh Ghosh has raised the hand.
Oh, Poritosh.
So you take the question.
Yeah. Yes, Poritosh, carry on. Poritosh, ask the question. Yes,
the group is
you can write in the chat in case there is
Better you can write over the chat box, then that will be better, I think.
Okay, sir.
Write in the chat box.
I'm trying. Okay, sir.
Yes, can you see what is written in the chat box, or should
I can see.
Okay.
So I kind of realized that the group you had considered, mental linear group, okay, so that's so over a vector space, I do not know of any nonlinear groups, because you know, when you consider a transformation over a vector space, that's the linear transformations. All right. So over vector space, we only consider linear groups, and the kind of group I have considered, they are linear groups because they are linear group. We have approached them through this vector space theory, and we have. If you look at the works, whether Ian Short or my work, we have used linear algebra for the linear groups. So linear algebra played a role here, whether you take the linear algebra over complex number or over the quaternary number. Okay. So, and most of the groups that we use in geometry are linear groups. But there are nonlinear groups, all right? So there are groups, there are Lie groups which are nonlinear. All right. So there are these exceptional family of Lie groups. And yeah, I mean, I'm sorry, I mean, I don't know much about them, but there are techniques where you can approach them in a nice way. In fact, that's a good question, because I am also willing to learn something about them. And you see, there are these four rank one symmetric spaces of non-compact type I mentioned, right? So the real hyperbolic space, complex hyperbolic space, quaternionic hyperbolic space. Now there is one more symmetric space of non-compact type, is called Cayley hyperbolic plane. Now there the isometric group is nonlinear, and it's an open problem to classify reversible and strongly reversible element in that group. But the kind of technique that I am familiar with to solve these other cases may not carry forward to that case. So your question is good, but we can look at there is a text called Exceptional Lie Group. I'm forgetting the author's name, but there are many texts on exceptional Lie groups. You can have a look at them. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, and thank you, Paritosh, for asking this good question. It is a good question.
It's a good question.
Yeah.